Greetings, 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 amazing humans and aliens and robots and whatnot. It's time for me to reinstall my Endeavor OS because I've been messing too much around with it. So I was like, why don't I just install it with you guys? Because there are probably someone out there that want or are looking for a way to install it or a guide to it. So if it's not for you, then you don't need to watch this video. It's just for that one person out there that could use a little bit of a holding hand while they're installing Endeavor OS maybe for the first time. So this is the menu that you will be greeted with, and actually helps if I'm activating my VirtualBox. So you can power off, reboot, hardware information, memory test, boot existing OS, NVIDIA non-free, and default. So I'm on a virtual machine, so I will choose default. If you know that you have an NVIDIA card, you select the NVIDIA one. If you don't know what card you have or anything like that, like you're like, what is NVIDIA? Or you're having an AMD card or something like that, you just choose the default and you click enter. And we will boot into a desktop environment. And here you have it. This is the Endeavor OS Live environment. And you can go and poke around, you can open Firefox and look at that while it's installing, or if you want some information and whatnot. There's also a couple of things that you can do, like install community editions, update mirrors, change display driver, and it's yelling at me for using VirtualBox, troubleshoot and stuff like that, and partition manager. I just want to start the installer. If you want to install the community editions right here, save a BSPWM and stuff like that, you need to be online. If you want the installer here, the Endeavor OS installer, it has both an online and offline installer. But I just want you to click on this one here because you probably want to install Endeavor OS without, you know, just this stock standard Endeavor OS. And here's the thing, if you can go for the online, if you can go for the offline, but I am going with the online. It is by far the best. And don't be scared of this little window up here. They, for some reason, are enabling the debug window within the installer so you can see what's going on. You cannot close this one. If you close this one, I'm almost 100% sure that you close this one also. So just leave it open. And you have here like the Endeavor OS installer, and it's based upon, or it is a modified version of an installer called Calamaris, and you basically just follow the guides right here. So it has detected that I live in Denmark. Oh my god, telemetry. Yeah, this is telemetry, people. Figuring out what country you live in is telemetry. So if you are really scared of telemetry, well, you cannot install Endeavor OS, I guess. It's not bad telemetry, but it is telemetry. So I want, let's do pretty sing this. You know, you select what language you want down here on this bar here. Then you can click back, cancel, and next we just click next. Right now you have to set your time zone. So it automatically found out that I want to be to use the Copenhagen, Denmark time zone. So region, Europe and Copenhagen, and you can change it manually down here by clicking one of these here. But it chose the right one. If it don't choose the right one, let's say I'm in England, I can just click here on London, but it did choose the right one. So I just click next again. Now you select your keyboard. I know that there are some people out there that lives in Denmark that are using American keyboards, and there are some Germans that are using English keyboard and stuff like that. So you just basically just choose your keyboard, and the default is the one you go with. If you know what this is up here, you know that you have to select it. Let me put it that way. If you know what a Dvorak keyboard is, you know that you have to select that if you have it. Just go with the default one. Click next. Now it wants us to basically install it onto our hard drive, and I'm using the legacy bootloader here. What you are going to do, and now I'm not talking about the advanced or intermediate users, the best bet is always just to erase everything and install it. You can't go and replace, you can't go install along or other distribution or windows. You can also go and manually partition it, but you need to know what you are doing. If you want a video on how to manually partition, replace, install alongside, let me know. But most of you people out there, if not like 80 to 95% of you guys, just do this one here. Swap or no swap? So, this is a big debate still in Linux, and I don't know why. You can choose to have swap or no swap. What is swap? Well, swap is kind of like software RAM. You know, if you, let's say, 4 gigs or under of RAM, or you're using really, really highly RAM-intensive stuff, you may need RAM space so your running programs can overflow into your software RAM or your cache file or what you will call it. And some say that you should use a terminal, some say you should use a file. If you look at the official Linux kernel documentation, Linux reading swap partitions and swap files just as fast. So it don't matter if you're using a partition or a file. This is from the official documentation from the kernel. And you can have swap with no hibernation, and you can have swap with hibernation. Hibernation in Linux is not that well supported. I don't care what people say, it's 50-50. So if you want or are using a laptop and you want hibernation, just know that it can be a little bit iffy. Most people, I would say, just select a swap file. Why? Well, a swap file is extendable. You don't have to set aside a partition of your hard drive or a part of your hard drive. So if I go in here and do like this, you can see here now it's taking 8.8 gigabyte of my hard drives and putting that into a swap partition. And let's just say that's not enough. Well, you can't really resize that easily. 8.8 gigabyte is way enough for most people, to be honest. But just in case, why not just use something that's dynamic, basically meaning extendable, and works just as well as using part of your hard drive? Use a swap file. If you're really, really adventurous like I am and have 32 gigs of RAM, I never use a swap file or partition, and I never had a problem with Linux. Again, use a raised disk, basically meaning you will use the entire disk. And then use a swap file just to make sure that, you know, you have enough RAM. That's what most people should do, because that's what will work comfortably for most people. All of these other things down here is, now we are venturing into like intermediate to advanced users, you know, people that know what this means. They have used the systems before, they've done this before. We could make a video about these things if you wanted. But a little bit of an explanation here, you just click next. Now, this is kind of like amazing and not so amazing, because this is amazing for people like me, but for a lot of you guys out there that don't really know what this means, or it can get, or are new to Linux or EndeavorOS, this can be a little bit confusing. There are some desktops that you can choose from: XFCE, KDE, GNOME, i3, Mate, Cinnamon, Bocci, LXQT. And then we have printer support and support for HC printers. Again, I barely know anyone using printers nowadays. Let's be honest here. And then you have accessibility tools. This is kind of these three here: XFCE, KDE, and GNOME. Choose which one you want. If you don't know which one, what they are, just choose the first one. You know, if you don't know what GNOME is, XFCE is, or KDE is, or i3, or Mate, or Cinnamon, just choose the first one. It's the easiest. So I would just go and do that. I would just choose the first one. Disregard everything else, unless you have like accessibility, like a mouse reader, mouse tweaks, if you have impaired vision. Choose the base develop here, make sure this is ticked on, and then just choose the first desktop environment. Again, people will yell at me, you know, with their big head 5000 IQs, oh, you should check KDE or GNOME because it's more user-friendly. You know what? XFCE is plenty user-friendly enough, so if you're new and you don't know what all of this means, just make sure the base-del plus common packages is selected, and just tick the first one. If that's XFCE4, well, you're using XFCE4. Then we click next. Now we have to set up the user, so I will just type in an amazing username. You could here set the name of the computer, so I'll just do test VM. Now a password. It's a good idea to have a somewhat complicated password, but I will just use a six-letter, really, really amazingly highly secure NASA, NSA-approved, and NASA-approved computation keyword password, if that's the word. And we click next. Oh, sorry. Log in automatically without asking for password. If you're at home or you know you're the only one using that, using the computer, you can activate that. I just like to be prompted. I'm an old fool. Use the same password for administrator account. I personally don't like this, but it's the easiest and it's the most convenient for users to do. So make sure you have this one. Oh, my phone just went off. So make sure you have this one activated. Then you click next. It gives you a summary of what's going on and you can basically just click next. And it's reconfirming that you want to install it. You click install. And now it's going to install, and this can take, depending on your system and internet speed and all of this jazzle-lazzle-bazzle, it can take a long, long, long time, or it can take not so long time. But you will be greeted with a lot of, I think, beautiful wallpapers or a slideshow here of astronauts and spacemen and stuff like that. So let's come back when it's installed, and I will see who is calling me on my phone. see you in a bit, Ski. And now it says it's done. And it took a sweet ass time, around 10 minutes on my system. So you need to make sure that you enable this one or tick this one on. Oh, my phone keeps going off or on. Restart now. And then what do I click down here? Well, you click done. I don't know why they have next and back there. It should just be done. That's a really, really bad UI design. And it did eject my ISO or CD-ROM drive or DVD. So it's still booting up the installer DVD that we have in our ISO. So you just click boot existing OS down here. Or make sure to take out the USB drive or whatever media you have used to install Endeavor OS. And now we should be greeted with a fresh install of Endeavor OS. Just have to wait for it to wake up. It takes a little bit of time. And here we are, and this is my username. I just have to use my NSA, NASA, whatever it is, secured password to log in. And we should be greeted with our desktop of choice. And we just selected the first one, so we are getting XFCE, and that's it. And now we are getting this amazing thing here, the welcome screen, where you can update the mirrors, update the system. But it's a good idea to kind of Google what these things means. The first two here is the ones that I want you to basically use. So update the mirrors. So I'll just click that one. You select what country you are in, and then you basically just click OK. And you click this one here, save to. This would just say save. You don't need this here. But anyway, you just save, and then you put in your password. Authenticate, that's it. And then the next thing you're doing here is updating your system, and there's nothing to do, so I will just click OK. Then, if you don't want this anymore, every time you open up, you click this one here, don't show me anymore. There's also some general information, some tips, and some add more add-ons, but I will just basically close this one here, so now that's not coming up next time I'm rebooting. And then you can basically just start using your Endeavor OS system. And you can start learning about Arch Linux and Endeavor OS. That's basically it. We have now installed Endeavor OS, and it's about 15 minutes on my system, if not a little bit shorter. Well, I did pause the recording. So 20 minutes, I think. Let's say it took me 20 minutes. See you all later. Bye-bye.